What I'll try to do is, first third or so, give you very general pointers about what you need to think about when setting up a study. Then talk about a couple of novel methods. I put quotes on the novel because, well, the theory behind them started to be developed about 100 years ago. They've only been put into practice over the last maybe 10, 20 years, so fairly new in terms of application, not so new in terms of methodology, and then give you a little bit of background on three examples where we've used these designs. So, what am I talking about? Talking about experiments in general, which is where we systematically vary some variable of interest. So, for example, giving different drugs, giving different doses of drugs, and see what the implications are for an outcome of interest. Typically, good practice is random assignment between treatments in order to avoid confounding variables. And one of the probably most famous statisticians, Ronald Fisher, quite a while ago, made the statement about experiments that if you contact a statistician after you've done your experiment, more often than not, you're asking him to do a post-mortem, decide why the experiment didn't work, why you didn't get the answers, or answer the question that you're hoping to do, and what the experiment died of. So, what is statistics good at? Well, statistics is very good at answering a single question asked once. So, for example, if I'm asking the question of, is there an association between my experimental treatment and a control treatment on nausea, and these are my data that I have observed, I can do a chi-square test, find a p-value, find a log odds ratio, find a confidence interval for that, and conclude that there is only, in this example, a 1 in 100 chance that such an imbalance in nausea is occurring only 1 in 100 times by chance if there is no difference between the two treatments. In other words, we're saying it's very unlikely that that difference has occurred simply by chance. Okay, statistics is rather bad at answering many questions or answering vague questions. So let's suppose we're playing cards and I'm asking myself the question, what's the probability of observing an ace, king, queen of clubs? I can work that out. It's about 1.2%. Of any suit, I can work that out as about 5%. But if I'm playing, I'm probably interested much more in what's the probability of having a useful hand, an interesting hand. And pretty much the question is so ill-posed that statistics is not helpful in answering that question. Even less useful if I'm then asking, well, how likely is it to get an interesting hand once in an evening? Just don't know. Now, one of the problems is that we are asking questions repeatedly. So, just as a simple example, if I conduct an experiment comparing treatment to control, no relationship between the two treatments, and I test that same hypothesis multiple times. Each time, if I'll claim a success if the p-value is less than 5%. Well, if I ask that question once, I'll get the probability of claiming a success when there is no difference of 5%. That's my definition of a p-value in the first place. But once I start asking the same question twice, it increases to about 8%. Asking five times, it's going to go up to about 14%. And if I keep asking and asking, eventually my type 1 error, my probability to claim that there is a difference when really there isn't, is going to be 1. And that's obviously a problem because if we do an experiment and just repeat it, repeat it, repeat it, eventually we're going to find something that is significant. Okay, so what are the implications of that for experimental design? Well, the first implication is, no, what is your primary question? That means if you plan a clinical trial, then having three co-primary endpoints is possible, but not as useful as having a single primary endpoint that you're going to use to make a decision about the effectiveness of a treatment. If you really have to ask more than one question, make sure that there is this inflation in the type 1 error. There is an increase in the probability of claiming a difference when there isn't, and potentially correct for that multiplicity, for the fact that you have multiple tests in your study. And finally, make sure that whatever your primary outcome is, make sure that it's meaningful and that it's measurable. An interesting hand, I can't work with. I just don't know what that means. It needs to be clearly defined. It needs to be clearly measurable. Other potential pitfalls in your experimental design, in your study design, are bias, and I'll talk a little bit about different versions of bias on the next slide, is the validity of your results. Can you generalize what you've seen within your experiment, within your study, to the broader population? If you do a study on 36-year-old males that are between 1 meter 90 and 1 meter 95, it's probably very difficult to extrapolate what you see in that very narrow population to everybody. And the other factor to think of is confounding other variables that could have influenced my outcome that I haven't taken account of. So there's a famous example that claims that the drop in birth rate in West Austria is linked to the drop in the number of storks in the area. Sounds rather interesting, but clearly we can't claim that the birth rate has dropped because of the drop in the number of storks. What has happened was simply industrial revolution during that time and introduction of contraceptives, and therefore the birth rate has dropped. The fact that the storks dropped at the same time had nothing to do with that. So make sure that you account for all the possible confounding variables in your study. Okay, thinking a little bit more about bias, there are different types of bias and a couple of fairly straightforward ideas that you can use to adjust for the bias. So the first one is selection bias, who enters the study, and also who gets assigned to which of the conditions. The simplest way to deal with that is simply randomized. What we want to avoid is we want to avoid the investigator choosing the patient that's probably going to benefit from the treatment anyway, no matter what they get, to be assigned to one of the two consistently, systematically, because it will bias our results. The second issue comes from two treatments that work very differently. So suppose you're in the great situation that your experimental treatment works fantastically well, control treatment doesn't work so well. What will happen? Well, patients on the experimental treatment will most likely stay on the treatment because, well, they're seeing benefit from it, while patients on the control treatment will probably drop out. And that will introduce a bias in your comparison between the two treatments. To avoid that, or to reduce the problem induced by that attrition bias, try to follow patients, even if they've decided to stop being part of the study, ask them, make sure that you're allowed to use the follow-up data, if anyhow possible, and that will reduce the bias induced by the attrition. There's something called the Hawthorne effect, which is essentially saying that subjects react differently if they are in an experiment. Very little you can do about that in a clinical study because you're going to have to inform them that they are going to be part of the study. However, what you can do is you can make sure that at least there is no difference between the groups that you're trying to compare, and therefore blinding patients to which treatment they are going to be assigned to is going to help you reduce that effect. Because you basically have the same change in behavior on both groups, and therefore your comparison is still going to remain valid. And finally, substitution bias is when patients on a treatment that doesn't work are going to look for treatment that hopefully works better for them. So again, in the lovely situation where your experimental treatment works well, the control patient may well seek alternative medications in order to see an effect. To deal with that, once again, blinding can be used because patients don't actually know which one of the treatments they are on, and therefore the effect of swapping is hopefully going to be similar in both groups, making sure that the comparison between the two remains valid. Okay, so that's the first third or so, just very briefly talking about good practice for experimental design. I'm now moving on to talking about some more advanced methods for clinical studies specifically. And to do that, I'll go back to the start and start off with the probably most common and straightforward clinical trial design, which is called a fixed sample, single stage design, which is probably what you are very much familiar with. It's a study where I'm comparing treatments, one treatment against control. I'm going to plan my study. I'm setting my design, set the number of patients that I require, start the study, recruit, wait, recruit, until I have observed the required number of patients, the primary endpoint for all the required patients, and then I'll look at my data and analyze the data and make my decision. This has the advantage that I know precisely how many patients I'll need, and if I can predict well how many patients I can recruit, I also know how long the study will take, which is a good thing. The problem is that a lot of times in a study, the study data are the first time or one of the few times where I actually learn something about the population and the treatment of interest. Yet I have no way to adjust based on what I've learned during this study. So, what do I mean? In order to fix my sample size, one of the things that the statisticians might ask you is, what is the expected response rate on the control group? Or they might ask you, what's the variability in your primary endpoint? For our comparison, we don't care about these values, but they are intrinsically important for us to set the sample size. However, a lot of times we don't have any very useful information on that. We might have information on a related population, we might have information based on studies that have been done 20 years ago, but the trial data will be the most current information about these variables, and therefore not adjusting is, if possible, certainly going to help me with the design of the study. So what can I do? So this is just a simple schematic of a single stage design. So here is my sample size. I wait until I have my N observations. Here is my decision criterion, my test statistic, and if my test statistic is large enough, I'm going to proceed, do whatever I'm going to do if my trial is successful, and otherwise I'm going to abandon. Alternatively, I could use something called a group sequential design, or sometimes called a sequential design, or sometimes called a multi-stage design. The setup of that design is quite different from what I've just shown you before, because here we plan the study and fix the design, but in contrast to before, we are not actually setting the sample size. Then we start the study, but rather than waiting until the final analyses to look at our data for the first time, we are allowing for interim analyses, looks at our data, and at each of these looks at our data, we're going to be able to make rather drastic adaptations to our design. Basically, there are three decisions that we can make. Firstly, stop, treatment doesn't seem to work. Secondly, stop, treatment seems to work brilliantly. Third, don't know, need more data. So clearly, this will be much more efficient than what I've shown you before, because treatments that aren't working are going to be, trials on treatments that aren't working are going to be stopped quickly, while trials on treatments that work are also going to be stopped quickly, or can be stopped quickly. Now, obviously, there is no free lunch, so we can't just do that without getting some penalty. I've already told you at the beginning that if we ask the same question multiple times, which is exactly what we do here, and so on. So we're asking the same question multiple times, and therefore we're going to have to adjust for multiple testing. And the implication for the design is that the maximum sample size of the study, that is, if I happen to have to go all the way to the end, will be larger than if I use a single stage design, no more than 10% typically. But at the same time, the expected sample size, so my average sample size if I were to do the same, the trial over and over and over again, is going to be notably smaller, up to 20 to 30% reduction in sample size is possible. Okay, so this is how such a multi-stage group sequential design could look like. So if my test statistic is in the red area, I'll stop and give up. If my test statistic is in the green area, I'll celebrate. I found something that works, I get excited, and I can move on to do whatever I'll do. And in between, need more data. So this is how it could look like. First two analyses, we find that our test statistic is in the continuation region, meaning we need more observations. But at the third analysis, we cross the upper boundary. And so rather than having to use a total of n patients, we only needed to recruit N3 patients. Okay, now we can push that idea forward even more by thinking more generally about adaptive designs. I already said earlier that a group sequential design is making rather drastic adjustments, stopping and not stopping. But obviously, we could think of other adaptations. And so more generally, adaptive designs are designs that follow this same structure. So I'll start the study and then have a sequence, or maybe just one, interim analyses. But at each of my analyses, I can adapt my design. So for example, I can choose whether or not to stop the study. Or I could choose to change my sample size. I was saying previously, the statistician might ask you for control group response rate, might ask you for variability of your primary endpoint, but you might as well use the data accumulated to estimate what that variability is and go back to your sample size calculation and revise the number of patients that you require in order to avoid an underpowered study, in order to avoid wasting resources by recruiting too many patients. Or I could drop a treatment if I have multiple treatments, and so on and so forth. So lots and lots of possible adaptations I could make in such an adaptive design. Same benefits and drawbacks to the group sequential design. Your maximum sample size will be larger. Your expected sample size tends to be smaller. But in addition to that, you're likely going to get a more relevant answer to your question, depending on your adaptation. Okay, so what are the advantages, disadvantages, more broadly, about adaptive designs? Well, the clear advantage is they're very flexible designs. If I made a mistake during my design phase, I can remedy it. I can change my design to account for that mistake, which is great. On the other hand, they're also very flexible, which can be a problem as well. If I think about a study in cancer, and it was decided initially that my primary endpoint is response. So does the tumor shrink sufficiently, yes or no? At the interim analyses, decision is made to change that primary endpoint to progression-free survival. So how long does it take until the tumor grows again? Because it's felt that that's the more relevant endpoint. And then an interim analysis later, somebody thinks, well, actually, what we really care about is survival of the patients. And adaptive designs will allow you to do that. You can change your endpoint if you want to. I'm not saying you should, but you could. Why shouldn't you? Well, suppose you end up with a study that's significant. Well, what have you shown? I can't tell you. You've shown that somewhere between response rate, progression-free survival, and overall survival, there is a difference between the treatments, which is probably less useful than asking the straightforward question of, is there a difference in response rate? So being flexible is a good thing, but only if you use that flexibility in a sensible way. The designs are very efficient. I've already told you that if you made a mistake in your sample size calculation, you can change that, you can adjust for that, which is a good thing. On the other hand, they are also inefficient. Inefficient in the sense that if I had known what sort of adjustment I'm going to make, I could have designed a more efficient study. Now, clearly, one is always clever with hindsight, but in practice, what that simply means is think carefully still at the design stage and only revert to adaptation if really necessary. Don't go into the study thinking, oh, I don't know what I'm going to do, and so I'll just try and then I'll adjust however I want to. It reflects medical practice. Surely, if a doctor doesn't see an effect on a certain treatment, they will stop that treatment on the patient. Why should you do the same? Why should you continue with the treatment if the trial data tells you that the treatment isn't working, for example? They are more complex to design, so rather than taking maybe a week or so for the statisticians to come up with a sample size calculation, we usually don't engage with any study where we don't have at least 2 months time to think about setting up the study. They tend to be shorter or lead to more precise answers at the end. But having interim analyses might require unblinding of the data. So again, an additional practical complication that just needs to be thought about beforehand. Who is going to be unblinded? How can we make sure that we don't introduce bias through our interim analyses? Okay, so let's just talk through three quick examples of adaptive designs. And I'm not going to give you any details about the method, the mathematics behind it, but rather focus on why we've chosen that sort of adaptive design in that particular instance. So the first one is a phase 3 study to evaluate survival on reconditioned lungs. So we're talking about lung transplantation. Basically, there was a method developed that meant that lungs that previously had been unsuitable for transplantation could be washed, cleaned, and hopefully would then be suitable for transplantation. And so the objective of the trial was to see, is the survival on a standard lung transplant the same as if we were to use these reconditioned lungs, these cleaned cleaned lungs. The problem at the design stage was that there was lots and lots of uncertainty about the treatment. At this point in time, worldwide, only 50 transplantations had been conducted using these reconditioned lungs. And therefore, a lot of the assumptions that we had to make in our sample size calculations were based on rather uncertain data. There were approximately 140 transplantations per year that could be done using these reconditioned lungs. And so the design then allocated in a 3-to-1 ratio in favor to the standard lungs. This was simply done to make sure that we use all the information on the standard lungs that we could possibly get, because those would happen anyway. And more observations improves our power, therefore a good thing. That's why we biased the allocation in favor of the control group in this instance. We had two interim analyses. Both interim analyses were allowing the trial to be stopped because the treatment, the reconditioning, doesn't work. And both of those analyses allowed us to stop the trial because we could show that the reconditioned lungs are at least as good as the standard lungs. And we used something called an O'Brien and Fleming boundary, which is essentially a design where you use very little type 1 error at the first stage, about 0.002% of your 5% use at the first stage, use about 0.005 at the second stage. So you need really strong evidence early on in order to stop, for the benefit of having almost unchanged maximum sample size. The most important thing was we've included a sample size re-estimation at the final interim analysis, simply because there was so much uncertainty at the time of planning the study. Only 50 transplantations had been conducted. At the time of the second interim analysis, we would have had data on an additional 200 transplantations with the reconditioned lungs. So therefore, 4 times as much information than previously available, and therefore it would have been foolish not to use that information. Now, I'm talking about this trial in the past tense because the trial was stopped. The trial was stopped by the safety monitoring committee because there was an unexpected safety signal. Had nothing to do with the design itself. The reason why I'm mentioning that is just to reassure you that the standard processes that are in place in a clinical trial still hold. So just because we used an adaptive design here didn't change anything about all the other things that need to be done in a clinical trial, such as making sure that the patients are safe. Okay, second example, a multi-arm, multi-stage design. So here we're looking at a phase 2 study to evaluate treatment for a side effect of HIV tri-regimen therapy. And we're looking for a superiority trial. We're looking to show that the treatment reduces insulin resistance in HIV patients. The trouble with the treatment, or the challenge with the treatment, was that the treatment has been used or is being used in hypertension. So there's lots and lots of data already available. And all these data suggest that there isn't a monotone dose-response relationship. In other words, rather than what you typically would assume, more of the dose means better effect. In this case, we weren't certain about that. And therefore, rather than going into the trial with the highest dose, the highest safe dose, we investigated three different doses of that treatment. And our endpoint was not semi-continuous change in insulin resistance. So the trial used three active arms compared to a control, used equal randomization between each of the active arms and control, and we had one interim analysis, and at that interim analysis, we again could make one of three decisions, and that is one of three decisions for each of the doses. If the dose doesn't perform well enough, it's out. If it performs fantastically well, great, we get excited, stop, or need more data. So our interim analysis was set up so that we selected which one of the doses was the most promising dose to be used. Now, the interim analysis for that trial happened about a year ago. Two of the doses were dropped, and one was taken forward, and final analysis is due to happen in about 2 months' time. So, update later. Final example, just touching on Bayesian designs, which almost all Bayesian designs are going to be adaptive, hence I've merged them in here. Who's ever heard of Bayesian methods? Okay, half and half maybe. Just in short, basically a Bayesian design or a Bayesian method works in the following way. You have some prior information, a relevant trial, expert opinion, historical data, something that you think is relevant for your study. Then you collect study data, and the Bayesian approach then combines these two sources of evidence, the data that you've collected together with the prior information, to come up with what's called a posterior opinion about the treatment. These methods are particularly helpful in situations where it's very difficult to recruit, so where the number of observations that you could get is too small to be practical. It's also very useful for situations where you know a lot about the treatment already. If you're thinking about treatments in children, you will have done treatment studies in adults before. So you know a whole lot about the treatment. Therefore, rather than reinventing the wheel and going back to the drawing board, you could use the information from the adult trials, that's your prior information, plus some data in your in children to come up with a decision about whether or not the treatment works in children. So this is, are the advantages and disadvantages. Firstly, we can use all the information formally that's available at the beginning of the study. We just combine all this information in a prior distribution. We can then obtain so-called predictive probabilities, which are very useful for communication. So I can tell you that a typical patient will have a 60% chance of benefiting from their treatment. Very easy to understand measures of effect. And therefore, those gives you those designs give you a scale that is typically easier to understand for a non-statistician. There are some challenges as well. Firstly, most people tend to ignore type 1 error in that case and get really excited when the Bayesian sample size is much lower than the standard frequentist sample size, when really the only difference between the two is the one uses a 5% type 1 error, the other one uses a 20% type 1 error. Sample size estimation is more complex. A lot of times it's simulation-based rather than based on analytic formulae. Therefore, it takes a little bit longer to set up and plan the studies as well. And finally, whatever you put in at the beginning, whatever your prior is, it will always be there at the end. That is not in itself a problem, but regulators, for example, prefer traditional approaches for licensing if there is a chance for you to recruit the relevant number of patients. So here is a final example, a Bayesian trial in rare diseases. The phase 2 trial in children with childhood polyarthritis nodosa. Over 4 years in Europe, all over Europe, we can only recruit 40 patients. Traditional sample size would have been about 350 patients required. So clearly a no-go. We can't do the standard trial in this case. However, the control treatment has been used for 35 years. So clearly there's lots of information on that treatment available. And so what we did was we used a Bayesian method that incorporated the historical information on the control treatment. We used a formal expert elicitation in order to define our prior distribution. And then still included some control data to make sure that the data in the past are still representative of what's going on right now. But we heavily skewed allocation towards the new treatment, a 5-to-1 allocation ratio, in order to learn more about the new treatment and come up with a final decision, which is due in about a year and a half's time. So, new methods get the results faster or more, give you more accurate answers. They tend to take more time to develop. And I think the only real thing you need to think about is it sensible for you to use these methods? Is it practical for you to use these methods? Can you do an interim analysis, for example? In other words, if I have a treatment where I can recruit everybody in a day, but it takes me a year to observe the primary endpoint, an interim analysis is not going to do me any good. Because by the time I have data to make a decision on, everybody is going to be in the study already anyway. Similarly, if I use a Bayesian method, can I do the Bayesian updating, which is computationally intensive? Can I do that in real time? Thank you.